Greetings to everyone. Welcome to BTN eShikshana program. For the course Building Services 3, 18 ARC 63, BIARC 6th semester for the session April-August 2021. I am Dr. Dakshani R. Patil, course faculty and associate professor at BMS College of Architecture, Bultanville Road, Bengaluru. So we have been looking at the modules 1 and 2 in this discourses. So previously we have completed part of module 1, that is mechanical ventilation and introduction to the fundamentals of refrigeration, refrigeration cycle, the various terminologies, refrigerant, and we have started with understanding the heat load calculations and parameters. So we are going to proceed with today's e-class session ahead, and this would be module 1, section number 2, which is titled as Basics of Heat Load Calculations. So before we actually begin the understanding on the various formulas in place for heat load calculation, we will look at the parameters for the same. Now, indoor comfort conditions are basically adjusted keeping the comfort level of the users or the occupants. Now, on a general note, the comfort conditions are dependent on the various factors, such as the place in question, it is subjected to that, because a coastal city as against an arid inland land would have different outdoor conditions, and outdoor conditions impact the indoor comfort levels. But as a thumb rule, the advisable ranges, unless specified, would be inside temperature of around 23 to 24 degrees Celsius, relative humidity around 35 to 60 degree, optimum 50 to 60, air movement 4.5 to 7.5 meters per minute, so as not to create a severe draft nor stagnation. So a very pleasant movement of indoor air for best ventilation purposes is advised. So keeping these few ranges in place, indoor design, indoor climatic or indoor environmental conditions are decided. So now, heat load parameters and calculations. So before we start the calculations and the formulas in place, we will understand what are the parameters that will impact the heat load calculation in a for a building. So firstly, by the outdoor design conditions. So what does it mean? Your building is located on a land in a particular city, and that particular city is a part of a certain geographical zone with its own climatic implications, thermal levels, etc. And we have seen how we calculate these based on a peak period identified for the particular city. So under outdoor design conditions, location of the place in question, definitely, because in terms of latitude, the altitude or the elevation of the place, the outdoor thermal temperature, relative humidity of the place, like we discussed, a coastal city would have a high prevailing humidity, whereas a desert would have the RH at a lower level of the spectrum. So these will form a very important part of heat load calculations and parametric attributes. Secondly, orientation of the building. Now we have the four cardinal directions, north, south, west, east, and also the subcardinal, northwest, northeast, southeast, southwest. So these also impact the functioning of a building with respect to the heat gain and other aspects. So orientation of building also becomes a crucial aspect in the understanding of heat load parameters. Third point, the internal conditions, internal indoor environmental conditions for the different spaces of the building. So what it refers to is primarily indoor temperature and the relative humidity. So these two are important or main aspects for listing the indoor internal conditions. Further, the building enclosure. The building has many structural elements to it. The walls, the windows, the ceiling or the roof overhead, right? So insulation levels of the walls, ceilings and floors. So is the building well insulated? Is it designed with the right materials and right parameters to enable good amount of insulation levels? So we have to understand that also. Followed by the window specification. Now windows mean coming with its own surface area of glass. So glass has a typical thermal conductivity, so that R value has to be understood. Solar heat gain coefficient. So each material has its own thermal conductivity and heat gain coefficient. So these are standards which are available as ready reckoner tables. These have to be identified, because windows, glass specifically, becomes a catchment surface area for the thermal heat. Then infiltration and ventilation levels. Now however we design our building, the skin of a building, it will have a lot of fenestrations, the windows, the doors, the openings, and these are designed, but whatever said and done, there is an amount of infiltration of the outdoor air bypass air that keeps happening. At either junctions or through the louvers, when the doors are opened and closed often. So infiltration via various punctures in the building. The puncture could be by default or by design. And the ventilation levels. So infiltration of fresh air, infiltration of outside bypass air. Infiltration of fresh air is a designed intent, whereas the other might happen because of either faulty design or overlooked design aspects in a building scheme. Then interior and exterior shading. So shading is basically when you would want to shade the building or the openings from the solar rays or the heat and the light. So how is the interior and external exterior shading that is designed in the building? That is another important parameter under building enclosure subheading. Then internal loads. So inside the building is always occupied by people. People, equipment, lights, etc. So taking the case of occupants in a building. So we have to know what is the number of occupancy. Because people perspire, they give out carbon dioxide and add to the humidity content of the indoor air. So understanding the internal load also is important, because one person occupied as against 10 people occupied spaces, the heat load aspects would differ drastically. So understanding the internal loads with respect to number of occupants. So this is a a broad classification of aspects that have to be understood under parameters towards heat load calculation. So once we know what is the heat gained or incurred by the building, then we can design for a suitable cooling load of the air conditioning system. So unless we know these, we will not be able to decide how much tonnage of AC our building requires. Hence, it is quite a crucial aspect of HVAC design in any building, and we have to be aware of this. So moving ahead, let us take a typical example, a case study of a building which has a semi-basement, 1+1 floor. Now we are looking in this, what are the heat loss locations? What are the points in the building where heat is going away from the building? So let us see one by one. Point number one, loss through exposed walls. Yeah, walls also are conductors. There is a transfer of heat from high to low always. So if the indoor temperature is high, it moves to the out. If outdoor temperature is high, it comes inside. So now if you notice this image, we are looking at nighttime heat loss location. Because as a general understanding, when do you want the building to retain heat? It would be when the outdoor conditions are naturally cooler. So that would be during the post-evening night times or during winter times. So that is when heat loss has to be calculated. So heat will be lost from the house or from the building through exposed walls. So the material of the wall, the thickness of the wall, all this will contribute to this parameter. Second, the roof ceiling loss. The various roofs, in this case you find two cases. So how is the loss incurred from these two points? Loss through basement floor. So in case you have a basement or a semi-basement, it also gives away because this is hotter than the soil. So it moves from that to the soil. Fourth one, infiltration loss at all windows, doors and cracks in the envelope. So wherever you have, like I mentioned, fenestrations or punctures in the building, and however sharp the human skill is in creating the frame, sealing it, there is always some amount of infiltration that keeps happening at these kind of junctions. So doors, windows or cracks, or improper filling up of gaps. Then heating may be required for ventilation, of course. Now as a design, if the inside temperatures are say in single digits and we would want to heat up during the night times or winter times, we will adopt some heating HVAC. So heating may be required for ventilation also, that is essential to be calibrated. Loss through below grade walls, number six. If you have anything below the soil level, again that is going to act as a heat conductor from inside to the outside. Loss through windows and doors itself. So the previous one was through the unintended cracks or loose junctions in the frames of the windows, shutters. But this is when you have ventilators, louvered ventilators or windows, or doors which keep opening and closing because people moving in. So loss through windows and doors. Loss through attic knee wall. So in case you have attic and you have these kind of projections as part walls there also. So these are probable points of heat loss from a building to the outside. I hope this is clear. And when you are designing air conditioning system which requires both heating and cooling, to calculate the heat loss, we have to list out all these and step by step enumerate it as a concise calculated sheet. Second one. Now, what are we looking at? Peak cooling load. So, peak cooling load would mean what is the cooling load the building is expected to be designed for, and when would this normally happen? When the outdoor temperature is more or high, substantially high than the indoor. Hence, we are seeing this picture at a daytime. So, summertime or peak daytime is when our HVAC system will depend on the cooling function. Now, what all do we see here? It will be similar to that. Number one, through exposed walls. Again, walls are acting into out there. Now, here the wall is going to act from the outside to the inside. Walls, exposed walls or the skin of the building. Conduction through doors and windows. Solar gain at glass, wherever you have window or glazing or curtain walls or fixed windows, ventilators. So all these places, solar gain via glass. Solar is the sun's energy which is coming to us. Sensible and latent infiltration gain at windows, doors and cracks. Sensible and latent gaze for lights, equipment and people. So inside you have these people who are giving out, the users who are giving out heat, the appliances which are giving out heat, and the various lighting fixtures across the building. Ceiling gain via the ceiling. Gain through attic knee wall. Sensible and latent appliance loads. So sensible and latent. Latent is one which is laden with water vapor. Cooling may be required for ventilation. So these are various aspects of heat that could be gained in a building, and accordingly what should be the cooling load to keep it cooler in a HVAC system. Now we'll start one by one, the parameters, understanding, and what are the components under these headings. We'll begin with building characteristics. The first point would be taking a look at the architectural plans, sections and elevations released by the architect for estimating the building dimensions or the areas or the volume. So to decide on cooling loads or heating loads, we need to actually know what is the quantum of area we are addressing, or that we have to note down. So how we will not be able to, unless we have the technical scaled drawings with us to calculate the dimensions, area and volume. External or and internal shading. How are the windows or the balconies shaded, and what is the design of the chajjas used, projections, ground reflectance from the surrounding site area. Construction details. What are the various aspects of the structural component, like ceiling height, what is the height of the room, columns, beams, quantum of these kind of elements. Materials used for construction of external walls, roofs, windows, doors, internal walls, partitions, ceiling, insulating materials, and the various thicknesses of these. External wall and roof colors. Colors also matter a lot. What absorbs the heat and what reflects the heat, right? That we have to understand. U values for walls, roof, windows, doors, partitions, etc. Check if the structure is insulated and or exposed to high wind. These are other add-on aspects that we would want to know. So under the building construction characteristic parameters, these have to be essentially noted and understood by the architect to arrive at the right heat load calculations. Amount of glass, the type and shading on the windows. Sometimes we go in, glass comes in various thicknesses, various U values, reflective values. We have double glazing, we can insulate the glass, we can tint it, various colored glasses, types, thicknesses, all these will impact on the building characteristics. Second, building configurations. So configuring something with various spatial configurations. What is the orientation of the building? If we have a building with a longer side on the south facing and we glaze it completely, the heat gain definitely is going to be on the higher side. So these things also matter. Shape of the building. Curved, rectangular, sharp edges, rectangular and being east-west oriented or north-south orientation, etc. Shading from adjacent buildings or trees. If your building is well shaded by a thick canopy of trees or has tall buildings around it, definitely the heat incurred is lesser. Function of the space. If it is a space which has around a room of 5x5, which has 10 computers working there, somebody's created an office there, definitely that lab is going to give out more heat. As against if that were treated as a living space. So function of the space, are the processes happening, are there, is it a manufacturing factory, is it a lab, is it a cooking zone? So that also impacts, so building configurations. Thirdly, outdoor design conditions. So by this we mean what is the weather data for the particular place. Temperature, RH, precipitation also, that also matters. The latitude, longitude, elevation or the altitude of the place. Higher the altitude, we are going towards cooler places. That comes. Period or time of the year, the peak time. We have seen this. How we deduce this as the point of time which has the highest heat gain in the year, and also identify the time. Indoor design conditions. So those same aspects but for indoor. So indoor, when we come in, we have the dry well temperature and wet well temperature, because there are people who are perspiring and adding moisture to the air. So dry well temperature and wet well temperature. The relative humidity, ventilation requirement of that particular space or the building, permissible variations and control limits. So ventilation requirement varies. If I were in auditorium of gathering of 500 people, then, or if I was in a hospital ICU, or I were in a game room, or I am in a gym. So everything has its own requirement of ventilation that has to be identified and noted. Permissible variations or control limits in a particular zone. Indoor loads. What indoor loads in the sense, what is adding to the indoor heat generation? So what do we see here? The first one, lights. You have various types of lights, fluorescent and focus, etc. So lighting adds to the heat gain. We have the people, the occupancy, who who are occupying the space and giving out perspiration and heat, and thirdly, various equipment and appliances. Everything, I think these days homes and offices are furnished with the maximum possible equipment or appliances. So modern day buildings are heat generating machines in themselves. So apart from the left picture also talks about the solar radiation coming in, the conductive heat gains, conduction is through touch, infiltration of outside air which is hot naturally during hotter climates. So it could happen through windows or through the cracks and junctions in the building wall. So this is about indoor loads. Lights, occupancy, equipment or appliances. Heat gains. Now we will just summarize the type of heat gains that we are going to experience across the above. Sensible heat gain. It is the energy added to the space due to conduction, convection and or radiation. So these three modes of transfer of heat adding to the sensible heat gain. Latent heat gain is the energy added to the space when moisture is added by means of vapor emitted by the occupants, generated due to a process or through air infiltration from outside or adjacent areas. So when the air is laden with water vapor, it becomes latent heat gain. Radiant heat gain. The rate at which heat absorbed is by the surfaces enclosing the space and the objects within the space. So via radiation. Space heat gain. Heat entering into and or is generated within the conditioned space during a given time interval. So during peak office hours, the labs are running full-fledged or movie theaters running a particular movie, etc. Space cooling load, rate at which energy must be removed from a space to maintain a constant space air temperature. So if you want to cool the space, how would you cool the space? You cannot destroy the heat. You have to just take the heat from inside and send it to the outside. So how much capacity of HVAC would do this kind of work of removing the heat to the outside is about space cooling load. So these are some of the terms pertaining to the heat gains. Now in addition to the five aspects that we saw, building configuration, characteristics, indoor design conditions, indoor heat gain because of people, light, appliances. There are, that is not all actually. There is another list here, additional considerations for heat infiltration. So duct heat loss. When you are providing duct in central AC, which we are going to study in the future classes, the duct is going to run between the AC plant or AHU room and the space to be cooled. So that duct is running in a non-air conditioned air, say below the ceiling and embedded in the false ceiling. So because of that, the duct is insulated, but not so much. There is heat loss, duct leakage. So you will have two ducts meeting at elbows or changing the size of the duct when it reaches a small room. So these junctions also become cause of duct leakage. Fan energy. Fans are at work. Otherwise, the systems wouldn't run. Blower fans, suction fans. So these also energy contributing. Return air system. So getting in the used or vitiated air from a room into the system requires a blower fan behind the evaporator. So that fan also is running and heat generated. Outside air infiltration. So all spaces air conditioned will have some amount of outdoor air coming into the system intended, designed to do so. And maximum of the air keeps recycling or cleaned and put back. So there is that air which is coming in, plus there is due to some reasons air coming inside at the dampers or through some unintended openings or cracks. The type of system that is used to provide the HVAC also is critical. The capacity of the system, the energy it consumes, the fan power of the motors, of the fans, etc. So these additional considerations also add up to the heat gain in a given building. Now, this is like a summary of what we saw. So you have the sun, outdoor temperature, range given here. Then what are the surfacial things that you will see? Surface temperature of the roof or exposed to the sun. Then you have the roof ceiling gain, exposed through gain through the exposed walls all along. Duct gains, because see, I mentioned the ducts are not in an air conditioned space. They are in a non-AC zone. So that becomes, ducts will gain heat from the outside and reduce the temperature of the cooled air which is running through them. Conduction through doors and windows. Solar gain at glass. Glass is a very good absorber of heat. Sensible and latent gains for lights, people, equipment. Cooling requirements. Sensible and latent application loads, appliance loads. Gain through walls and floors from unconditioned space. Not all spaces in your building are conditioned. There may be the base corridor, some passages and service zones which may not be under air conditioning. So there, roofs and walls not exposed to sun, to outdoor temperature, outdoor temperatures, external shade, same as north glass, etc. So these become so these are the various points of infiltration of heat into the building or the other way. So next class we will be seeing the heat load calculation formulas ahead in the next session.